Hey, what's up guys, Jeremy here. In this video, we will talk about robot singularities. Let's get started. If you have any kind of hands-on experience with robots, you might have stumbled upon singularities. Maybe you know how they work, maybe you don't, but at the end of the day, you know they are trouble. So in this video, I will explain you what robot singularities are and how RoboDK detect them. So let's start by opening the next station, so 07E singularities. As usual, if you go in the description of this video, you will find the link to download the files. Don't forget to like and subscribe while you're here. Here we have the 07E singularities. So we're just gonna start with a cuckoo robot. Before we jump into singularities, I need to kind of explain a bit of the vocabulary. Oftentimes we compare a robot arm with a human arm, and we use the same kind of body part to talk about certain section of the robot. So for the section joint 1 and joint 2, we often refer to the shoulder, joint 3 will be the elbow, and the group of joint 4, 5, 6 will be the robot wrist. You have three types of singularities you'll be facing. So either the elbow singularities, elbow singularities, shoulder singularity, or wrist singularities. In this video, I will mainly concentrate on the wrist singularity, and then in the next one, I will talk about the elbow and the shoulder singularity. So the wrist singularity is the one you are the most likely to face with industrial robots, mainly because of how they're built and the kinematic they use. So most people will tell you that a wrist singularity happens when joint 5 equals 0. This is in most cases true, but the real answer would be the wrist singularity happens when joint 4 and joint 6 are aligned. Most of the time this occurs when joint 5 is at 0, but the concept of joint 5 being equal 0 is just kind of a consequence of joint 4 and joint 6 being aligned. So there's kind of two reasons why we have a singularity here. There's a mathematical reason and there's a mechanical reason. The mathematical reason is the fact that when joint 5 and joint 6 are aligned, just gonna make this one visible here. I don't need to see the robot flinch. When joint 5, joint 4 and joint 6 are aligned, there's an infinite number of answer to the mathematical, let's say, equation to reach a given point. So I could move the joint 6 1 degree in one direction and joint 4 1 degree in the other direction, and I will still have the tool at the same spot. If I do the same 2 degree in one direction, 2 degree in the other direction, the tool is at the same spot. So if I show you here cuckoo wrist singularity infinite, I'm gonna bring it here, you will see that joint 4 and joint 6 are moving in opposite direction, but the tool itself ain't moving at all. So there's an infinite amount of solution for one given equation or one given position. So that's problematic. There is also the fact that if you were to try to go through the singularity at some point, because you have that kind of motion of the two joints, but no motion of the tool, you're kind of just getting stuck, you're blocking, the robot gets blocked in that position, physically speaking. So mechanically speaking, there's a limitation there. Most robots will give you an error before you reach that point, unfortunately, or they will simply trigger an error and stop. So depending on what kind of robots you're using and what kind of controller you're using, the behavior will always be the same, it won't work, but some will simply give you a warning and stop the robot, some will simply try to hit the singularity and then you will trigger kind of a motion trigger or same thing as a collision almost. If I hide here and make this one visible here, if I bring back the robot to its own position, obviously here at home you have you are right in the singularity. So if I double click the robot here, you will see that joint 5 is at 0 and joint 4 and joint 6 are aligned. If I run, I have here two positions here that I created. Sorry, I'm going to activate this tool here. I have one position here and one position there. Here in theory, you can't go through that with a linear motion. With previous version of RoboDK, if you were just to click once on it, it would try to do a linear motion and it would stop, but it was a bit annoying when you're trying to just program. Now RoboDK will announce or warn you if there's a singularity, but only if you try to cross it while generating a linear motion in a program or trying to execute a linear motion within a program. So in this case here, let's run this program here. So I'm going to the first position with a move J, and then I'm trying to reach that point here. And you see here, joint 5 is too close to a singularity, 0 degree. Then we're going to discuss about that later. So if I double click the robot and take a look at it, my joint 5 is at 2.38. So if I take the slider here, I go from the first point I requested with a move J, so it doesn't matter if there's a singularity or not, it's just going to match the joint values. And then it tries to move in the linear fashion. Here, if you look at the joint values, we start at like minus 34, then we increase towards the zero threshold, and then bam, at minus 238, it stops. Why does it stop at minus 238 and not at zero? It's because under tools, option, and motion, you have a tolerance to avoid risk singularities in degrees. So in this case, it's 2.5. I would always recommend you to have a tolerance there because you don't want to go directly to a singularity. You want to kind of keep a threshold around it that you want to avoid. Some robots will actually accept you to go closer than 2.5 degrees to a singularity. Some will accept a higher value than that. So it's kind of your job to test it out a bit on the real robot. Try to do a motion that is close to the singularity and figure out where the robot stands on that matter. And then you can adjust here the value to match your real robot behavior. So here, anytime you are within minus or plus 2.5 degrees, RoboDK will warn you and will stop the program. If you were to go near the singularity, so here you have another program where I'm just going near the singularity, you would see that here at some point I have kind of a big rotation of joint 4 and joint 6 to be able to match the motions here close. So if I'm further, like there's not much rotation of joint 4 and joint 6, and as I run the linear motion and I get closer and closer and closer from the singularity, joint 6 and joint 4 will accelerate to kind of compensate from the fact that I'm going near the singularity. If I was to go really on the singularity, like I said, it will block physically speaking, but at some point I would have to have both joints moving at an infinite speed in opposite direction. We all know that when we're talking about real world stuff, infinite speed is impossible. So that's kind of what happens with a singularity. Like we're hitting a void where things are just not possible. We'll talk about that more in details when we talk about speed in robot speed and cycle time analysis and everything. But going close to singularity can cause the robot to slow down, because at some point you might reach the maximum rotation speed of two joints. So potentially the speed you're requesting the robot to go at in terms of millimeters per second is just impossible in this specific area because of the limit of rotation of a given joint or a given set of joints. That's enough for this video. I don't want to make it too long. In the next one, we will talk about shoulder and elbow singularities. I will also talk about cobot singularities, and I have a few videos that I want to show you that better explain on real robots what occurs when you are hitting a singularity. So I hope to see you there. In any case, have a great day, guys.